this is the kind of second half of March 16th lecture. That is the final lecture in preparation for problems at heat. Not too much left to do. So let's look at how to translate this sentence here. Some cube is left of every tet. Just to be clear on the meaning of it, here's a world where it would be true. So there's some cube in the world, maybe it's this one, that is left of every tet. That is, take any tet in the world, that cube is left of it, so the cubes must be, you know, maybe one here, you know, one here perhaps, and one here. Okay, so notice in that world there is a cube that's left of every tet. Now, maybe not all cubes are like that. There could be others that are in other places, like maybe it's going to be a cube over there, for example. So we're not saying that every cube is left of every tet, but there's at least one cube that is left of all the tets. That's what we're trying to say here. Okay. Now, you might notice that you've got an existential there, and you've got a universal. So quite likely, this is multiply quantified, that is probably those two quantifiers will have overlapping scope. And also there are different types. So now we're getting to more difficult cases. But it's still not too bad, because we can still more or less stay with the square opposition. As long as we stay with the square opposition, our brains should be able to cope with these translations. So, trick here is to translate in two steps. So the book calls this two-step translation. So step one is where you try to translate the overall structure. Translate the basically to translate the main operator. Either the main one operator or perhaps the main two, which gives you the overall structure. Now, that's going to leave some parts untranslated, but don't worry about that. You can take care of those at stage two. In this case, it looks like the overall structure is a sum S is P. Saying there is something that has some property. Right, so let's figure out what the S and the P are here. There are those. So it looks to me like it starts with some Q. That is, this is our S here. But what is the P property? What are we saying is a property of at least one cube in the world? Well, it's complicated. It's the property of being left of every tet, right? So let's just say that property of being left of every tet is our P property in this case, okay? So that's the overall structure. Sum S is P with S and P identified. Now, we know that sum S is P is translated in a certain way. You have this memorized by now, I hope. If you don't, then it's high priority, get this done. Only three sentences to memorize from the square of opposition. Sum S is P is for some x, Sx, and Px. So let's put that in here. We're going to say sum x, Sx, which is cube x, and sum always goes with and on the square of opposition. X is left of every tet. Oh my goodness. X is left of every tet. That's complicated. I'm just going to leave it in English. X is left of every tet. Just like that. So that's stage one. Notice we haven't finished. That's okay. We'll finish on step two. Step two. translate the leftovers. In this case, x is left of every tet. Now, usually what happens is that the leftovers are also, well, no longer a sentence, I guess a woof, but on the square composition. X is left of every tet. Isn't that the same as, you know, every tet is something X is left of? Maybe not something, maybe that's confusing. Every tet has X left of it. Okay, X is left of every tet. Every tet has X left of it. And now it looks like a standard every S is P sentence. Every student is poor, which we know translates to for all X, SX, conditional PX. And a quick reminder that on the square of opposition, universal, you know, conditional. So that's the most common case. Every tet has X left of it, then I guess it's going to be for all, well, you know, we can't use X anymore, because now our scopes are going to be overlapping. Notice when we say every tet here, we're in the scope of the X quantifier, so we need to pick another variable. Y, perhaps. I usually start with X and go to Y. You can do U and B and T and W if you like. For all Y, tet Y, conditional, it's like PX here, X has left, X left of it, or every tet, yeah, left of, and I'm going to get this the right way around. It's the tet that has X left of it, so X is left of Y. Y is the tet, X is the cube. Yeah, it's the cube that's left of the tet. X is the cube, Y is the tet, X is left of Y. All right, and then we can then, I'll just stick it in here. X is left of every tet, put this in, roll Y. Y, conditional, left of, X, Y. So, and do I have enough? One more breath. So it ends up looking kind of complicated. So you may or may not be able to do that in one step. If you can't do it in one step, you can do it in two steps. That's the idea. Let me do one more example. This was a sum, let's try with a no. No cube adjoins every godic. All right, again, this picture of a world where that would be true. I mean, in this world, there might be a cube that adjoins a dodec, like this, right? That's adjoining. And maybe there's another cube here that adjoins another dodec. But now there's no cube there that adjoins all the dodecs, right? This one doesn't adjoin that dodec, and this one doesn't adjoin that dodec. There might be another cube. Join any perhaps, but certainly there's no cube that adjoins every dodec. Just like in a certain class, you know, there may be no boy that has kissed all the girls, right? Or maybe no dog that has found all the bones, you know, things like this. No cube joins every dodec. So the overall structure is clearly no S is P, right? And the P property is the property of adjoining every yogic. No cube has that complicated property. So first of all, we've got to translate no S as P. And you may remember that there's two kind of equally easy ways to do it. You can say that it's not the case for some X, SX, and PX. There's nothing that is both S and P. Or you can say for all X, if SX, then not PX. Now, there's other ways too, but these are the two kind of simplest ways. Alright, so whenever you have to translate a no sentence, you just pick one of these. They're both correct. So pick whichever one you prefer. I usually pick the first one, but it's just for fun, you do the second one this time. So then we have for all x, sx here is cube x, conditional not, and then it's the property of joining every dodec. So x adjoins every dodec. Just like that. And then we have to translate x adjoins every dodec. Sometimes it's helpful to turn it around, so you could write that as every dodec has X adjoining it. Right, and then this is a all S of P sentence. In other words, for all X, S, X, conditional T X, and then yet for all X, dodec X, conditional something about adjoins, and again, you've got to get it the right way around. Now, I realize that adjoins is a symmetric relation, so in a sense, it doesn't matter to get it backwards. At least you'll end up with something logically equivalent, but really, I want it to be not just logically equivalent, but first order equivalent. So, really, you need to get it the same way around. So it joins x is in the first place. Oh, I can't use x. Huh. So that'd be y. It joins x, y. Again, I have to pick another variable here to the universal because for the new universal, we've already got x taken. So this says every dodec has x adjoining it, and then I stick it in. I'll write it down here, for all x, if x is a cube, then it's not the case this is that every cube has, every dodec is adjoining, so we leave the not there, and then for all y, dodec y conditional joins xy, that's that bracket, and we still need this bracket. And there's the answer. So, yeah, this is getting kind of complicated, but the good news is that we're pretty much at the final exam right now. It gets something slightly harder than this, maybe, on the final. This is about the complexity we're looking at. All right, so the end is in sight. Yeah, now, before we have the final sentences left for this week, I want to do. And this is kind of like the worst case scenario, or worst case we're going to look at. Here we're not trying to do translation. We're just trying to understand the damn thing. Okay, if somebody writes down this sentence, well, I guess we're translating it into English, but we're not translating from English back into first order logic. Let's look at this sentence anyway. Some x, negation, some y. Log y, negate, x, y. Okay. got to recognize this is a bad one, okay?
What tells you that this is a bad one?
Well, when you look at the front of the sentence and you see the quantifiers, ideally, you see similar quantifiers like sum, or all, something like that. If you see different ones, then that's bad news. And with three or more operators, it's the more changes that signal bad news. So for example, if you had for all not sum, that's pretty bad, right? Or if you have, you know, not sum not, or all not all. With all of these, you've got two changes. You're going from a sum to a not, and then a not to a sum. Or, you know, they're not similar quantifiers or other operators. So with two changes, three operators, this is a bad one. What are you going to do? Well, essentially, the answer is go from the inside out. In other words, similar to the translations we were just doing, you take it in stages, okay? So let's start right from the middle, dot y, and bit x, y. Now obviously, x and y have now become free variables, because we've pulled off the quantifiers, they're just free variables. How do we translate free variables? Well, treat them as names, okay? Of course, they're not going to be names later on when they're quantified, but while they're free, we're going to treat free variables as names. Treat them as kind of fixed meanings, in other words. So, y is a dog, and x bit y. Or you might say, y is a dog that x bit, or something like that. Okay? You can say it in various ways. All right. Now, at each stage, then, you put one of the quantifiers or other operators back on that you took off. So let's now put the quantifier back on, the first one, the inner one. First one applied. Now we have. For some y is a dog that x bit. And try and translate it into English again, keeping it as simple as possible. Simplicity makes it easier to understand. Do you need to move the camera? So what's that? How are you going to say that in English? For some y. Why is a dog that x bit? Well, basically it says, you know, there is a dog that x bit, or just simply x bit some dog. It doesn't say whether x is a cat or a snake or what, but x bit some dog, all right? And now we put the not on, okay? Put the not on there. It's not the case. X bit some dog. Well, that means that X didn't bite any dog, or you might even simplify it to X bit no dog. X bit no dog. And now we put another operator on, happily the last one. Some X bit no dog. What does that mean? There is some X such that X bit no dog. I don't know the best way to say it, but there is a thing, we don't know what it is, that bit no dog. In fact, as far as my memory serves me, I am such a thing. Pretty sure, through my long life, I've never bitten a dog. I did bite a dentist once, let's not say anything about that. Got into a certain amount of trouble over that, and I was only 2 years old at the time. Anyway, I'm pretty sure I've never bitten a dog. Anyway, the sentence is asserting that things like me exist in the world, right? And it
it's actually not too bad if you take it step by step. If you try and just sort of look at this, and the head starts to swim, you know, the thoughts just become foggy, and it's not easy to grasp. But if you kind of work carefully from the inside out, keeping your English as simple as possible at every stage, then I think it's not too bad. Now, I just want to mention, this is going to work, but on Prompt 8, there's this nasty question, which is rather similar. It's also an existential negation, another existential, this one here. And to sort of help you build it up step by step, as I've done, I've got a series of simple sentences, and you just keep adding operators on the front, hopefully build up the sentence. Notice that it's an existential, so if it's true, there has to be at least one value of x that makes the with inside true. And actually, it is true, the whole sentence is true in this world up here, and I want you to identify which object, which value of x actually makes the sentence true. There's only one. So you can, I guess you can point to it, you know, on the sheet, or you can just describe it in words, like you might say small dodecahedron in the middle. By the way, it's not a small dodecahedron in the middle, it's a hint for you. One of the other objects, okay? You can either point an arrow to it or something, or just describe it in some way. Okay, and the very last one is kind of a fun exercise. All you have to do is label the diagram with the name of each object. Each object has a name, actually, there, or at least one name, some have two. And the information you need is unfortunately given to you in the form of first order logic sentences. So it's really just about understanding what these sentences mean and taking that information to label something. So, for example, this first sentence, according to the hint, tells you right off the bat which one is D. So if you can understand what that says and look at the world, you can immediately label one of those objects. Okay. All right, so I think you should be ready.